Thank you very much for your warm welcome, everybody. I've just had a most fabulous week in British Columbia. It's my first visit to this side of Canada, and I'm not sure it's the Christian hospitality or the Canadian hospitality or the two in constructive superposition, but I've had it just a lovely week. That remark is for the physicists. You'll know what I mean. Greetings to you from brothers and sisters in Durham University. This is the old bit of Durham University. That's Durham Cathedral. I just like to put that up because we have skylines too, but they just old skylines, but this is a castle. This is Durham Castle. It was built by William the Conqueror. Well, I think he had people build it for him, but you know what I mean. It's nearly 1,000 years old, and we think it's the oldest building in which students currently live in the world. It's very oversubscribed at summertime, and when the winter comes, and the students find themselves described by what it's like really living in a medieval castle, it's too late. But just here, do come and visit us in Durham. It's the north of England's medieval jewel, but it's also been a place of scholarship for hundreds of years. And in this little end of the cathedral there, this little chapel called the Galilee Chapel, is buried one of my early medieval heroes, the Venerable Bede. You might have heard of the Venerable Bede as the 7th and 8th century historian. Maybe you don't know, he wrote a science book as well. It's a lovely science book which he wrote for his monks and friars and for the people they were to pastor, which he prefaces by saying, the reason we learn about nature is because people, when they see the lightning strikes or the storm come or the earth tremble, they shouldn't believe that there are spirits or wicked things coming out to get them, but that this is the way that nature works. This is the way God made it. So you learn about nature to cast out fear. And if that were good enough for Bede in the year 700, I think it might be good enough for us. I think that will work us end at that point. Should we have questions now? No, we don't want to. So let me just tell you what I'm going to talk about and what motivated me to write this book. I will try not to make this a book sales talk. I might mention it one or two other times, but you get cross with me if I do mention it too much. But here are my prejudices. Why am I writing a book called Faith and Wisdom in Science? So we are going to spend some time thinking about faith. We're going to be time spending some time in the Old Testament wisdom corpus. And I just learned there's a class here who's been learning about Proverbs. He's like, give me a wave for people who are learning about Proverbs. Where are you? I'm sure. Yeah, hooray. Thank you. Well, he's the teacher. Where did they come? Where are they? They didn't come. They did come. Thank you so much. I have found the Proverbs slide. We're going to go to Proverbs. But most of the time we'll be in Job because my contention is that Job is the place where you start in the wisdom literature if you're thinking of biblical material to help you learn about a theology for what science is. But what does that mean here? What I'm looking for, one of my motivations come from being a scientist today, when that feels that science to me is part of what makes us human. We do science in the same way that we write love poetry, or sing songs, or tell stories, or paint pictures. But you wouldn't know that, would you, if you tuned in today's radio or television or media presentations that tell us what science is and what it isn't. It feels like a bit of a geeky thing. You've got to be a bit weird and odd and not very social to do science. And this breaks my heart because it leads to trouble, and I'll show you what the trouble is later on. Posh words, but after regaining the plot, I think science has lost the plot. Or in posh academic words, it needs to rediscover a cultural narrative, a story about what it is for being human. Okay? Here's another thing that I've already given you some information about. The other aspect of science that most people think they're being told is that science is a product of modernism, of the modern world. It's not there in the ancient or medieval world, which was all hidebound in church dogma and so on, and science is the final secular triumphant overthrow of all that, so the story goes. I'm not so sure. If Bede, a lovely, holy, pastoral, scholarly teacher in the 8th century, can talk about, he talks about natural philosophy, the wisdom of the natural world, science is a new word, and that's part of the problem. I think that leads us to the idea that science may be older than we think. Or, let me put it another way, that perhaps science, as a word, is the title of the chapter that humanity is writing now in a book that has many, many previous chapters in continuity with this one that go right back to the beginning of when humans were first human. And it's about our curiosity into nature. This perception, I think, that science is just modern is a harmful thing. I think it's harmful for several reasons. It impoverishes people's well-being because it cuts people off from the natural enjoyment they would have. Not as perhaps being scientist experts, but just enjoying the way that we're opening up the beautiful underlying structures of nature for anyone to understand. I start the book. Oh, here I go. To try and explain what I mean by inventing a world in which we've done to music what we've done to science in our world, and to try and explain what I mean, I say in this world people don't go to rock concerts, people don't go to symphony concerts, they don't hear string quartets, they don't go down the club and listen to the jam because that's for experts. You know, ordinary people couldn't possibly take in harmony and counterpoint. Or we might get the tune whistled to us on the radio the next morning. All these concerts, they happen, but they happen in special music laboratories where musicians in white coats and clipboards do the work. See what I mean? It's horrific, isn't it? I hated this. But that's what we've done. It paralyzes public debate. I'll say more about that in a little bit. And it certainly distorts this relation and our argument about religion and science, or faith and science, which I know you want me to talk about, and I certainly will. Oh, sorry, there it is. Last time, you see the front cover. So here's what I'm going to do. A few things to say, and then you can all do Facebook and Twitter for the rest of the talk. The rest is details, but here's the site. You have to listen to this first. So science-religion debate, or at least the people that say it. I gather Richard Dawkins is coming to Vancouver this weekend. I just heard. He's written some wonderful things about the history of science, but what he says about religion is not worth going to hear. I mean, really isn't. But you know, but in particular, this shouting, this extreme science and religion, and is a sideshow. I don't think it's even relevant. It's desperately boring. Once you've heard it, once you've heard it a thousand times, it's not the place. It's a sideshow, it's a diversion from where the real issue of engaging science and religion is. And I'll come on to where I think that is. Here's another bit of a funny thing. It's odd. Have you noticed how the science and religion discussion, it doesn't do much Bible study, does it? Really, it doesn't. It's not a very biblically informed debate. It informs itself about what it calls philosophy or a version of history that no historian would recognize, but it doesn't do much Bible study, and when it does, it tends to orbit rather closely around the first page of the Bible it sees, okay, which is Genesis chapter 1. Right? Now, to get me wrong, and in particular, I know there are Old Testament theologians here who actually teach Genesis, Torah is, as the Jews call it, is fundamental, it's very important to study it. But of course, as you, I'm sure you all know, at Trinity Western, the Bible is more like a library than a single book. And when we go to the library, we don't just automatically pull the book off the left-hand side of the shelf and start reading that one first and think it's the first place to start for anything, do we? We would go in and choose the right place to start reading. And for my money, as it were, the wisdom literature, that's the bit, you know, a few volumes in from the left, more or less in the middle of the shelf, is where I would advocate we start. And particular, yes, Proverbs, definitely Proverbs, but the Book of Job. I also think that in modern science we have things to learn from, again, a piece of science that's not often mined for the theology and science debate. Again, nothing wrong with thinking about cosmology or quantum weirdness, especially if Arnold's going to talk about that next few weeks, you should definitely come here and talk about quantum weirdness, or evolution, and those are the areas that are common. But the sort of science that I do, and it's not just because I do it, I think is an immensely rich field for contemplation on this. It's the science of how order emerges from chaos. Underneath all the substructure of materials, our cells, everything, as you probably know, if you know a little bit about science, that heat or temperature is understood at the molecular level as just seething, jiggling all the time, and it's utterly random. Have you all done that experiment where you take the rose the lovely soft rose, and you plunge it, you cool it down in liquid nitrogen. It's a famous school science experiment, isn't it? You cool it to 100%, you pull the rose out, it still looks like a rose, then you tap it with a hammer. Yeah, what happens? Shatters into shards like glass. Same stuff, same material, same atoms, you've just stopped the jiggling, the chaotic motion. Softness is an emergent phenomenon that comes when you combine polymeric molecules with random chaotic seething motion. So there we are, there's a thought to be conjuring about. And then what about theology and science? So this is what I say about this. So this tense debate of theology and science for about 10 years, I thought the problem was with the theology. It was old and fuddy-duddy and fusty and old, out of date, and it couldn't possibly cope with science. And then I started listening to theologians and reading some theology, and I realized that it's a very deep and flexible and interested and adaptable and thoughtful discipline and community, and it's not true at all. Theology can go with anything. Well, maybe it's the science then, the Dawkins crowd and the scientism and the fact that people are saying science is everything and nothing else counts. And a few people do that, but not the majority of scientists. Most of us, you know, science is hard. And for every question you eventually solve, you create 10 more. And your ignorance just opens up before you. That's the life of the science. It keeps you humble, it really does. So it's not the science. Then I realised the problem is with the and. That's the word that's our problem. That sounds great. How can an and, how can a chapter be a problem? I'll tell you how it's a problem. If I say I'm going to talk tonight about rich and poor, or north and south, or first nation and third nation, or second nation, whatever we call ourselves, or black and white, okay? What have I done with the ands? You see, my kids are, the lads played a lot of rugby at school at this time of year, and at the end of the summer holidays, the people will come out with the white lining things and they paint the rugby pitches, you know, the lines on the pitch. What do you play here? Soccer? Ice hockey. Oh, you can't put lines on that. You have lines. You don't have lines. I've seen you ice hockey. You have lines. So, it's the line, the and is the centre line on the ice hockey pitch. I'm talking Canada as well. It literally carves out the debate. And once you have the and, you know the game you're playing. But suppose you're supposed to be playing squash when you're on the same side. It's too late then. Suppose, the rule, maybe theology and science don't belong on opposite sides of the net. But it's too late and you've done the and. So what else might you do then? You might put an off there. So this is the question that I got interested in myself. So, the theology and science is the wrong question. It's what is the theology of science is the right question. You see, that's not the sideshow. The church has been on the back foot for all these years defending, trying to respond to the question, how do you reconcile your science with your faith? What about theology and faith? Oh, crikey, well, it's probably all right because we're looking at different domains and blah, blah, blah. The science tells you what and how and religion tells you why and all that sort of stuff. Nothing wrong with that. It's all very worthy. But it's all back foot stuff. No. I want to ask the front foot stuff, which we're supposed to do in the church. In the kingdom of God, there's no territory of life or world or action that isn't inside God's kingdom. So you don't have an and, which is the other side of the net. You ask the question, what does science do as God's gift within God's kingdom? What's it for? What's its telos, its end, its teleology, its purpose? You see, other disciplines on campus don't, other universities, secular institutions don't, almost are not allowed to talk about purpose these days. But we can, you can. And it's important, because purpose is a human need. We're in stories. Each one of us is in a story. And stories have beginnings and middles and ends, in both senses. Ends as finish and ends as purposes. So while the question we have to ask is what is the purpose of science within the kingdom of God? That's what I mean by a theology of science. That's what theology of means. And when we do that, we can reappraise science culturally, anthropologically, theologically, and the church can stop running away from science as if it were a bear in the woods and turn around and give it a great big bear hug. instead. Right? So, I've got to pick up some clues. What do people say about science? There's another painful strand about science. Have you noticed? Here's John Keats writing about, he calls it philosophy, science, you know, cold philosophy. Charms fly, he says, the mere touch of cold philosophy. He thinks science desiccates all wonder and glory from the world. There was an awful rainbow once in heaven, we know her roof, her texture. She's given now in the dull catalogue of common things. Philosophy, that is word of science, will clip an angel's wings, conquer all mysteries by rule and line, empty the haunted air and gnome with mind. Unweave a rainbow. Does science really dehumanise the world? Here's the evidence I have for where the trouble is today. That's one of the troubles, and I think John Keats' story still runs. But here's a social science project. I've been helped enormously in Durham University when I was vice president of research there. It's enormous to help me because I was in English Department on Monday and Geography on Tuesday and Chemistry on Wednesday. It was great, so I could go around to everyone and say, I write this book, I'm trying to think about the theology of science, and I need some social science, can you help me, or some history, can you help me? And everybody helped me, and the social scientists said, this is what you need, underlying narratives in European publics on science. You can tell a social scientist wrote that title, can't you? That's rude to them. But here we are, deepening they studied one of these troubled technologies. You know what I mean? Fracking, shale gas recovery, nuclear power for nuclear waste, climate change, genetic medicine, altering the human genome, all these science-based technologies that catch us out all the time, and the world seems to be going past so fast, and scientists can do so much, and what should we do? Should we do this or not do it? Should we touch that? Should we go there? Should we eradicate polio? Yeah, sounds like a good idea. Should we eradicate multiple sclerosis? Yes, of course. That means altering the human genome. Oh, should we do that? Oh, we don't. But you see, argue, and visceral responses are elicited, and we don't seem to be able to have adult conversations about the technologies with which we will be piloting our lives, creating the future. That, for me, this is not the sideshow, this is the real show. Because we don't know what science is for. So you're running a company, you always have value, you know, the first thing you do is your value statement, your mission statement. If you have a mission statement, then you know how to make decisions. Because you're right, you know what you're about, you know what your values are. If you don't have a mission statement or a value statement within your worldview as Christians, you have no idea how to make decisions about science. And because we've been running in the other direction from this problem all the while, we don't have the material we need to engage with society and help society and government and policy with these things as salt and light. Now, here's the evidence for that. Here's a project. You could do this for any science, but this was for nanotechnology. Do you remember nanotechnology? I know there are nanotechnologists here, actually. The science of the very small, some copying nature in making very tiny molecular or slightly supramolecular complexes that might be able to build interesting structures or maybe even heal diseases. But it created fear. Prince Charles, bless him. Do you remember Prince Charles wrote an article in which he claimed that if the nanotechnologists were allowed their lab time, grey goo would emerge from the laboratories and smother the whole of the Earth and attack us all, some science fiction horror movie. Dear, thank you, Prince Charles, that was great. So what happened was the social scientists and geographers at Durham and a number of other European universities analysed the structure of public debate around these questions, and had focus groups, and they analysed the media, and they, with this narrative analysis, you can look at the superficial arguments, and you can ask, well, what's going on underneath them? People are talking about risk and benefit, but there's something driving them. And if you're very clever with your narrative analysis, you can pull out the stories that are swimming underneath the conversations without surfacing, like giant fish or sharks. They cause the ripples, they never really emerge. But if you're careful, you can see what they are. And there are five ancient narratives, and here they are. Be careful for what you wish for. Don't do it. Don't open Pandora's box. Remember the Greek myth? Pandora, the Greek myth of the first woman in the world, had a box, she was a jar, and she was curious, and she opened the jar, and all the troubles flew out of the jar. They'd been kept by the gods, trapped in the jar, and she let them all out. And, of course, once they're out, you can't get them back in. Don't open Pandora's box. Don't mess with nature. Nature is sacred. Leave it as God meant it to be. That sort of, I mean, it's too late now. We live in the Anthropocene. And be kept in the dark. The scientists will keep you in the dark, will be out of control, and the rich will get richer and the poor will get poorer. That's the Marxist narrative. Now, the philosophy Jean-Pierre Dupuis, these narratives came up all the time. They are the narrative of desire. Be careful what you wish for, what you want. Don't open Pandora's box. It's evil. You let out the evil. Once you let evil out, you can't get it back. Don't mess with nature. The narrative of the sacred. Sorry, can you see? I can't really do much about this. So to get up, just stand up. Mark, he's got all the slides, so you can see afterwards. Or you can keep the book. You kept in the dark. Alienation and the narrative of exploitation. Now, I want you to notice, we've since done another project on GMOs, genetic modified organisms, in India and Brazil. And the same narratives appear. You can do this anywhere. I want you to notice two things about them. One is they're all negative. Jean-Pierre calls them the narratives of despair. Yeah? All, there's not a positive one. There's no encouragement to take a step forward. They're all deeply reactionary and conservative. The other thing you should notice about them, they are all pagan. Three ancient pagan narratives and two modern nihilist and Marxist narratives. There's not a single Christian or even remotely Judeo-Christian or even remotely Abrahamic religious story there. We have completely evacuated this field. We have run in the other direction. And mark my words, when the church runs away from the area in which we should be engaging, you don't leave a vacuum. There's no vacuum. Pagan, negative, despairing narratives rush in to fill the gap. So fun theology we're going to do tonight, I hope, but it's also a kind of almost a matter of life and death. This is the not shine show. This is where science and religion meets or want to meet and is not meeting currently. Never mind about the atheist versus creationist system. Please, sideshow. Here's another important. An important voice. George Steiner. I love reading George Steiner. It's from a book called Real Presences. George Steiner is a. I'm sure many of you have heard of him. Quite extraordinary. I think he's still just alive. He's an extraordinary literary critic and man of letters. I think he once held four chairs simultaneously in Europe and America. He writes beautifully and painfully about the postmodern world, the loss of meaning. This is in this book where he's desperately sad about the loss of meaning in the humanities and the thesis about Hamlet and how the humanities were folded in on themselves. He's very self-critical about the humanities. He's writing about art here. He's writing about purpose. He wants to look for purpose. He wants to recover the lost telos, the lost teleology, lost purpose. And he's talking about art. He says this, only art can go some way towards making accessible, towards waking into some measure of communicability, the sheer inhuman otherness of matter. What an extraordinary thing for a humanities scholar to say. Can you imagine what I, as a scientist, reading widely, trying to look for a search for purpose for science, thought when I read that? Only art, Mr. Steiner. I think you've told me what science might be for. Because if it is true that the part of the human condition is to feel divorced, feel incommunicable with the sheer inhuman otherness of matter around us. And other people have said this, many people have said this, Hannah Arendt, Heidegger in our own age, people in earlier ages. Then surely science is exactly this. If science is nothing else, it's reconstructing in our minds, in a sort of way that we construct models of other people in our minds, we're talking about that today, aren't we? Nature, in which we somehow befriend it. It becomes more familiar. We understand it. What did Bede say? We understand. We want to learn about our thunder and lightning so that we're not afraid by nature, so that we understand that this is the way God wanted it to work. And here's George Steiner talking about this need for reconciliation. I thought I'd better just tell you a little bit about the science I'm working on. I'm a scientist, promise. I'm a very trespassy scientist. I'm a physicist, but I didn't really stay in physics all the time. I love working with my friends in other disciplines, and I'm currently working with biologists. We call it biophysics now. So Little story we're working on now. Here's a protein. It's a bacterial protein called the catabolic activator protein. It's bound to this double helical molecule here, that I expect you can recognize. It's DNA. And the communication of information in molecular biology is one of the things that's fascinating me as a physicist. And here's a tiny little step in the chain of communicating information inside if you're a bacteria. I'm not suggesting any of you is bacteria, but if you were, you would have this in you telling you what you should be eating. And the DNA, this protein binds here when and only when. Can you see two tiny little red molecules here? That's called cyclic AMP. This whole big molecule will only bind to DNA when these two molecules have swum along and bound into these pockets here. It's called allosteric communication. And I'm just fascinated by the way that the signal is communicated through the molecule. What is more to the point is that the signal communication has a hard hill to climb, because the world isn't quiet like that. Remember what I told you about the seething molecular chaos? I'm going to show it to you. There it is. That's the atomistic model of cyclic AMP. This is another model of this protein, now at slightly higher spatial resolution, actually doing what it would do with time slowed down about 10 million times at room temperature. And you can see that it's wobbling about madly. So this communication has to take place. So it's as if one of the people over here was to whisper in a rather sotto voce voice to someone over the door over there. Or maybe you might be able to tell them where to meet up for a coffee afterwards if we were all quiet. But suppose we were all chatting loudly to our neighbours. No chance. This is the challenge. And yet, we've had a great fun. We have not time to talk about this now, but with the interdisciplinary team we set up at Durham between physicists and mathematicians and biologists, we worked out how this molecule does this by sending its message on the noise, on the chaos. It uses the chaos as a sort of sea to float the boat of the information. And if you turn the chaos off, just like the shattering tulip, or rose petals, the information flow will stop. Biology is really clever. And we see these phenomena all the time. It's not that the chaos is fought, the chaos is used to explore possibility and potential. Going through our clues, don't forget where we are, we're picking up narrative clues for a story. What's the story of science? One of the stories of science is that it's got a strange name. I don't know about you, I've never really liked the name science, and I like the appellation science is even less. And why is it a nasty sound? It's all sibilant and stuff like that, but why does it sound threatening? And of course the reason is, even if we don't know Latin, and Greek, where we are now, because we are all Latins and Greeks, and our language comes from there, we know in our, bellies somehow, where words come from. We know somehow that scientist comes from the Latin word scio, scieri, I know. And that when I say I'm a scientist, I'm making an implicit knowledge claim. But that's not what science used to be called. That's the 19th century version of romantic power play. What did science used to be called? Remember, it's natural philosophy. That's Greek, not Latin. Philosophia. Philo, Sophia, I love wisdom. So suppose I said, rather than think about science, think about the love of wisdom to do with natural things. Does that sound a little gentler, a little kinder, more inviting? The love of wisdom to do with natural things. That's the traditional language that describes science. And might that give us a clue of where to find the earlier chapters of our science story? The current chapter is called Science. The immediate chapter before us is called Natural Philosophy. It's got the wisdom tag. Perhaps we should look further back in time and follow the clue of wisdom to find what lies behind the story of science. Perhaps I should just mention, by the way, let's go back to the Enlightenment. Let's just knock on the head this story one more time, shall we? If anyone ever tells you But the scientific enlightenment is the triumph of secular humanism over medieval theological dogma. Just point them to their history books. Perhaps the iconic scientific revolution of the Enlightenment is the Copernican revolution, right? The discovery that it's not the Earth is in the middle of the universe, no, the Earth orbits the Sun. And the iconic inventor and imaginator of that is Nicholas Copernicus. Let's read what he says about what he's doing. To know the mighty works of God, to comprehend his wisdom, majesty, and power, to appreciate in degree his wonderful workings of his laws, surely all this must be a pleasing and acceptable mode of worship to the Most High, to whom ignorance cannot be more grateful than knowledge. Like bead, ignorance is not something God likes. Knowledge and wisdom he loves. I promise you, I could take you to any of the great Enlightenment scientists. Here's Kepler, I'm going to read this out as well. Newton, Boyle, Francis Bacon, the great philosopher of the scientific Enlightenment himself, draws on a medieval teleology of science, which is explicit Christian theology of the fall, that says that one of the consequences of our disobedience is that we lose the deep understanding of nature that God meant us to have. But by grace, he gives us our senses so that by looking and feeling nature carefully and by thinking with the intellect he gives us, we might rebuild through the thorns and briars of the painful exercise of experimental science the knowledge he meant us to have. That's the rise of experimental science. It's born in a Christian theology. And don't let anyone ever tell you again that it's not true. So we could go back further. Let's go to the Middle Ages. This is Trinity Western University. I'm sure you don't need the Latin translated for you, so I'll just read that for a moment. And you will see, of course, that there's Bishop Grosseteste, master to the Oxford Franciscans in the early 1220s and later Bishop of Lincoln, talking about light and matter, doing real science. I'm going to be talking about this Friday night at St. John's College in a wonderful, crazy interdisciplinary collaboration between scientists and medieval scholars. There we are, you know what he's talking about there. No, here's a bit of translation. I wish I could spend longer on this view tonight. Because he's a Christian, but he's reading Aristotle carefully. He takes on board most of Aristotle's science, but knows that because Aristotle's a pagan, he can't be expected to understand that their world has a beginning. For Aristotle, the world must have no beginning, because Aristotle cannot imagine a first cause. He doesn't have a creator God. But Grosseteste, we have a creator God. Grosseteste, we have to have an account, a physical account, of what happens scientifically when the world begins. In 1220, Grosseteste does not say answers in Genesis. Grosseteste says questions in Genesis, clues in Genesis, answers in the hard work we have to do by thinking about the world and looking at the sky. And because he knows that God created light first, he realizes that light has the power to fill and endow matter with extension, and he imagines that light blew the whole universe up in a giant expanding sphere at the beginning of all time. 1224 AD, I kid you not. There's the manuscript. and it's so physical we can even make mathematical translations of it and run computer simulations, and that's for Dawn. Okay. So the point is, we're going back in time. And Doctor Who, actually even dressed like Doctor Who. Coming to my TARDIS. Right. Now we're going back to the 4th century. I want you to take to the patristic era. Surely, as we go up eventually, if the stories are true, the dry little narratives that science is modern, we will cease finding anything recognizably like science, right? I'm going to take you to Gregory of Nyssa, one of the great church fathers, who wrote a book called On the Soul and the Resurrection. It's an extraordinary book. Gregory is the little brother of Basil the Great. So two of the great 4th century Greek theologians come from the same family. You can be reading this, it's great fun, it takes a while. Let me give you the context. These are the people who hammered out the doctrine of the Trinity. You know, the Jesus events were so powerful and so transformative. It took 4 centuries to work out intellectually just a shadow of what was going on. Isn't it extraordinary? You know, we have Origen and Tertullian and Arrhenius and these people, and eventually we get to Gregory and Basil, and they kind of polish it off, but only with the help of their big sister. Did you know this? One of the church fathers is a church mother. Is it true? Macrina. She's big sister. And what Gregory and Basil say is that they would never dare preach or publish theology unless they'd run it past big sister first. They called her the teacher, capital T, because she was the most learned among them. She taught them after their parents died. She wiped their backsides, probably, as far as we know. She has clearly a mind like a meat cleaver. If there was anything a little bit shaky in their arguments, she'd spot it a mile away and cauterize it. So they'd always run their theology past big sis first. But this is Gregory at her deathbed. He's distraught. She's dying in some pain, we don't know what she died of, but this book is actually the record, his diary record, of their last conversation on her deathbed. And it's so typical. She's the woman doing the dying. He's the man. Lost it. Absolutely lost it. Can't pull himself together. Doubled over with grief. So while she's dying, she does the cheering up. 'Twas ever thus, wasn't it? So much for the weaker sex. So she says, dear brother, you know, come on, cheer yourself up. Death isn't that, you know, it happens to all of us. I'm going to glory. It's gonna take a while, but while we're waiting, why don't we have a good old argument like the old days? Tell you what, let's have a good debate. We'll debate the reality of mind, or soul, it's sometimes translated, but the Greek is psyche, to which we get psychology. Let's debate the reality of psyche. You argue that there isn't, we don't really have minds, we seem to have them, it's an illusion because we're made of matter, and that mind or intelligence or consciousness is really a psyche, is an epiphenomenon of matter. Oh, I thought that was a brand new 20th and 21st century new cognitive neuroscience debate. Nope. Everyone knew that brains were made of sloshy stuff and that's what you did your thinking. Back then, of course, solid. You hit someone in the head, can't think of it. But I will argue for the reality of mind. So they argue for pages and pages, a beautiful text, and then Macrina delivers her knockdown arguments. And you've read it now. This is her knockdown argument. She says, I'll tell you why we've got mind. Think about an empty jar. And we realise, we think about it very long, it's not empty at all. Because when we pick it up by the neck and we push it under water, if it were empty, the water would just rush in and fill it, but it doesn't. It fights something called air in the middle. Look, the imprisoned air. It rushes in the contrary direction. Thus, water is checked by the strong current of air and gurgles and bubbles against it. Lovely language, even better in the Greek, I dare say. So you see what she's saying? We don't just perceive the world. If we did, we'd think the jar was empty. But we know there's a thing called air, even though we don't see air. We know it's there because we can create special events in which we can deduce it's there. We rebuild reality in our minds, not just how it's perceived, but how we can super perceive it to be. Almost as if we were recreating it ourselves. That's why we have minds, so the psyche. Then she says, it's like the moon. So if you have minds, we look at the moon. In fact, we notice that. Did you see the lovely crescent moon tonight? The little sliver of new moon? Beautiful, isn't it? Now, if we didn't have minds, we'd say, well, there's a little kind of wafer sliver thing. And then next week, it would look like a half penny. Oh, there's a half penny. And then next week, the week after that, it would be a circle. It might be like a big brown cheese. But we don't say that, she says. We know it's a sphere lit up by the sun. And as it orbits the Earth in its path, we see it's lit upside from different angles. So we have a mind. We rebuild the solar system. She doesn't know what to say about that, but that's what she's... So look... We have minds because we do science. There's no doubt about it. She's talking about doing science. You notice something else about this wonderful occasion. Doing science has become therapeutic for her and her brother in this grieving situation of her death. I bet the last thing you think of to heal a situation of grief would be to have a good science discussion. But it worked for her. Let's go up the Bible. I'm fascinated by creation stories in the Bible. One of the things I'm fascinated by is there are so many of them. Have you noticed how creation, a creation motif, is revisited over and over again in Torah, in the Pentateuch, in the Psalms, in Wisdom, in the Prophets. Some of the creation stories are quite long, some are quite short. We know the first two, Genesis 1, Genesis 2. Those are the first two, but there are many others. Proverbs 8, we'll visit Proverbs. I put in the Proverbs Psalm specially for you, not we're going to see it in a minute. Psalm 19 has a creation story, Psalm 33. So they're quite short, you blink and you miss them. The sort of basic creation text, they go something like this. The Lord creates the heavens and the earth. He creates the boundaries between the earth and the sea, the foundations of the earth beneath and the heavens above. It's a kind of three-dimensional bounding. It's a telling people, it's a putting bits of creation into their place. And they're used to bridge from positions of despair to positions of hope. It's kind of when you run out of gas. You know, when the enemy's around you, you've been exiled or something like this, and you tell a creation story, and you want to praise God, but you can't. You read the Psalms, are always in that position, aren't they? They're often, I want to praise God, but I can't. My heart's cast down within me. But the Lord, the word of the Lord, often the word of the Lord spoke, and the heavens and earth were created. And after telling the creation story, the psalmist can praise again. It's a wonderful thing. Isaiah 40 starts with a creation story. Isaiah 45, again, Jeremiah 10, Hosea 2. It goes on and on. John 1. First, in the New Testament, is full of creation stories. John 1 is a deliberate echo of Genesis. In the beginning was the word. In Arche Eto Logos, it's a deliberate echo of Genesis 1, and John wants to tell a creation story. It's a wonderful creation story. Question time. Let's look at Proverbs 8. Proverbs 8 is a special creation story, and it's great that you maybe put this in, because I call Proverbs 8 the birth of wisdom. And it is literally the birth of wisdom. Do you remember the Proverbs 8 story? Isn't it lovely? One of my favorite passages in Scripture. The Lord brought me forth, sings wisdom, Sophia. She's a little girl. She's a personified little girl, is this wisdom. Before his deeds of old, I was appointed. When there were no oceans, when there were no springs abounding with water, before the mountains were set in place, before all that, before, ooh, look, here comes a creation story, when he set the heavens in place, marked out the horizon on the face of the deep, established the clouds above, the foundations of the earth deep, when he gave the sea its boundary, so the waters would not overstep his command, and when he marked out the foundations of the earth. There you go. That's it. That's the earth creation story, from which Genesis 1 and 2 are developed versions of very interesting teaching, but this is where it starts. Filled with delight, day after day, I think of a little girl in the sandpit, yeah, playing at God's right hand. Curiosity and creation, the birth of wisdom. And then we get to Job. Now, here's a good, here's a thing. Did you know... I'm sure you do, those of you who are scientists, think of when you last went to an international conference, you've been to the conference, you've had a conference dinner, you're in the bar, and you're around the table with a bunch of scientists. Half the time the conversation, or at least a third of the time, conversation gets onto God. Gets onto God. Without forcing it, gets onto God. Scientists are just fascinated by meaning and depth and word behind what we study. And I love, when the appropriate moment comes, I said, you know, I think science is deeply there, or the tributaries, the source, the springs of science are right there in biblical literature. I said, have you ever read the Lord's answer to Job? When God finally speaks to Job. It's there in chapter 38. No, I didn't say that. And I said, well, tell you what. For my money, it's the most beautiful and profound ancient wisdom poem to do with nature ever written. Tell me about it at breakfast. Because, of course, thanks to the Gideons, I know that the one ancient document they will find by their hotel bedside is the Old New Testament, right? So they read Job, and they come back absolutely gobsmacked, as we say in Yorkshire. Amazed, because God answers Job not with a direct answer, but I'm sure you know it, with what? Questions. Yes, questions. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea? Where is the way to the abode of light? From whose womb comes the ice? Do you know the laws of the heavens? And can you apply them to the earth? Do you know why the Pleiades are bound together, whereas next door the stars of Orion are all cast apart? Do you know how the hawk navigates to the south? It's extraordinary. It's extraordinary for a number of reasons. For those of you who are doing scientific research, you'll know why it's so extraordinary, don't you? Because the difference between the undergraduate scientific world and the graduate science world is in the undergraduate scientific world, to succeed, you've got to find the right answers, haven't you? For the examiner or for your tutor, you've got to find the right answers. But when you get to be a graduate student, a PhD student, you suddenly find that all that cleverness at finding the right answers is completely useless to you. I say this, I'm so sorry, my new research students, I'm so sorry, lovely to have your PhD and well done on getting your first class degree, but all that answer finding is going to be completely different, completely useless to you, because what you now have to find yourself good at is to ask the creative, imaginative question. That's what unlocks the scientific process. It's not that Heisenberg says this, Einstein says this, everybody says it, myself. Hey, I'm not like Heisenberg and Einstein. So we better look at Job. Where does this come from? How are we doing? Oh, 15 minutes. Okay, we'll get there. David Clines, the world's greatest ever Job scholar, just retired from the University of Sheffield, so kind, let me, doing the study for the book, of the book of Job, let me have the PDF of his then unpublished final section of the book. He calls Job the most intense book, theologically, intellectually, of the Old Testament. And if he says this, who are we to disagree? Susan Nyman from Berlin has just, I noticed, written a web article last week, a long, extensive article in which she claims that Job is the origin of philosophy, not the ancient Greeks, it's the book of Job. I personally think that one has to take both into account, and one should go into the ancient world and turn left into Hellenistic philosophy, right into Hebrew wisdom, and bring them both together. But here's an outline to the book of Job. In the prologue, Satan, God, Job is allowed to suffer, not because he deserves it, and then these cycles of speeches, where Job's speech and his three friends alternate speeches. They actually, of course, he's suffering there. He's suffering dreadfully on his ash heap, and it's dreadful. And for a whole 7-day period, they do the right thing. They act as good friends, and they just share in silence his suffering. And then on day 7, they make a terrible mistake and open their mouths and start to try and explain why he's suffering. And we get these cycles of speeches and this hint of wisdom. And then Lord's answer comes at the end. One of the criticisms of the Lord's answer that you find in the secondary literature is that it's not a real answer. It's a petulant put-down. That's just a question. How can questions be an answer? It's as if God was saying to Job, how dare you get up and complain to me about your suffering? Well, what do you understand? Do you know where the light comes from? Do you know where hail comes from? Do you know how the stars move? Oh, you don't. Well, you don't know nothing, so why don't you just shut up? That's more or less the standard interpretation of the Lord's answer. I don't really agree with that interpretation. I think that is what God is saying to Job at all. The other reason that the Lord's answer is criticised is because it seems irrelevant. Job's problem is a moral one. He's complaining to God that though he is a righteous man, he is suffering. He's lost his family, his flocks, his riches, and his health. And it's not fair. He wants to be justified. And God comes with a load of tomfool questions about stars and badgers and so on. It's not relevant, is it? Well, let's tackle the second one of those first. Turns out that there isn't a single item in nature, not a tree, not an animal, not a plant, not a mountain, not a star, that has not already been talked about, metaphorically, in the cycles of speeches. What is more, as Job's anguished conversation with his friends racks up in intensity, they start talking hypothetically about, well, if someone were to sin, that man might suffer, hypothetically, not talking about anyone in particular. And then the second speech, well, maybe your wife or your children sinned, it's possible, isn't it? And in the third speech, the gloves come off, the third cycle, gloves come off, it's you sinned. And as this anger and tension, so the natural backdrop increases in intensity from inanimate nature, then animate nature, and then finally, this anguished third cycle, the whole of Hebrew cosmology bursts out once, of heaven's moon and stars. So in that one can take a nature trail through the book of Job, so stitched into the natural world is this book never leaving the argument. And that's what I think we've done. Look, we've read the beginning. It's nature itself that causes Job the trouble, the wind, the fire of God. The source, his own material, falls apart chaotically. He's afflicted by nature without and within. And he responds with, what happens in Israel when you're afflicted? Sing a creation song. Except this is where we begin to realize how twisted and dark and nihilistic the book of Job can be. Because Job sings an anti-creation narrative. Where we'd expect him to sing a creation one? He says, would that the days of my creation had never happened. Would that the stars of its dawn had been darkened, not lightened up. And this is where we first meet Leviathan, the beast beyond the beasts. Okay. He accuses his tormentors and God of acting like chaotic nature itself. He says, look, my brothers, my friends, they're as treacherous as the wadis. You remember what a wadi is? It's a dry Middle Eastern riverbed where you can't grow anything. And then if you do ever grow anything in the morning dew, then the floods come and they rush it. They sweep it all away. Dark with ice, swollen with soil. They're in spates. They vanish. His own body, again, is chaotically dissolving away. It's disgusting. And so the point is this, that Job's argument with God is a double one. It's almost Kantian, this, you know, the law of the heavens above me and the moral law within me. He says, God, no wonder you're out of control of the moral law. Not surprising, because you're out of control of the physical universe as well. Look at the lightning, look at the flood, look at the earthquake. You're out of control. It's all chaos. There's no law. There's no justice. Look, what God destroys will not be built. What he imprisons will not be free. He holds back the waters, there's drought. He lets them loose, they overwhelm the earth. That's Job's complaint. Oh, I hope you're enjoying the William Blake article. For those of you who prefer pictures than words like me, William Blake was one of the thinkers and artists of the ages, the thousands of them, that have clearly been inspired wonderfully by Job, and he produces these engravings. Is the Satan attacking Job in the first place. Periodical clash of hope and hopelessness. It's not true that his friends have all the bad news. Sometimes they have little glimmers of hope. If you read carefully, Job, you'll find little gems of wisdom. After all, at one point bursts out, I know that my Redeemer liveth and that I will stand at the last day. That's from Job. That's from Job. From that handle also said in Messiah. But here's Eliphaz in chapter 5, talking about the day when Job will be reconciled with God. Read it carefully. At ruin and blight, you will mock, and you will have no fear of the wild beasts. Be like Isaiah 11, yeah? Isaiah 2. For you will be in covenant with the stones of the field, and the wild animals will be at peace with you. What's the shocking phrase there? What's the real shock? What's the jaw-dropping blasphemy? Almost. Covenant with the stones. That's berit, that's the Hebrew for covenant. It's the same word that's used for the Abrahamic, the covenant between Yahweh and Israel. And here it is. You know, you have a covenant. You have a covenant between the king and a king, or king of people and people, and with Israel and God. That's where you have covenants with. A covenant with a stone? Stone. It's so abhorrent that some translators have bottled out. There are versions of the Bible that don't translate covenant as covenant. You just can't bear it. But here it is. I think this is David Kynes, anyway. But just think about this relational story that which has begun to appear from our narrative clues. And I wonder if having a covenant with the stones, recovering a relationship of peace with nature, is perhaps a telos that might deserve the word covenant. And yet Job lets the despair sometimes slide away from him. That's the mountain slide into the sea. Here's the cosmology, third cycle. But look how twisted this is. Again, this twisted, nihilistic aspect of Job. What does God know that he's here to think? Look, Job, God appears in the clouds, in the height of heavens, among the topmost stars, and he's veiled. When God appears in Epiphany, he is veiled, yeah? God's always in a cloud, usually, or normally, so that we aren't shocked by his sight, yeah? But, in this case, God's clouds stop him from seeing out. It's awful. It's so twisted. This is philosophy gone badly, badly wrong. And there we have the suspended earth in the clouds. So there's a point where the arguments run out. And I said when we go to the hymn to wisdom, we must just look at this briefly, because this is where our search for wisdom ends. Because this is the search for wisdom. A poem comes in at this point, but announces itself halfway through as the search for wisdom. But it begins in a strange place. It begins down a mine. Here they are, dangling and swaying in a mine. Look, a foreigner, it's always the immigrants that have a dangerous job. Foreign race cuts the shafts, forgotten by travellers. They dangle and sway. Can you see the miners in the mine, looking up at the rocks? What they can see the source of lapis and the flecks of gold. And then the writer makes this extraordinary observation. He says, look, think about human beings in a mine. They see the earth from underneath. Not even the hawk with her sharp eyes or the falcon sees that. Those animals only see the superficial crust of the earth. However sharp their eyesight might be, human eyes see underneath the structure of the seams of precious metals and stones. And then the search, this is what makes humans special, the special type of seeing and perceiving the structure of the world that isn't just there for everyone else to see. And then finally the search ends with God's knowledge of the way to wisdom. God understands the way to wisdom. Why? For it is he who knows its place, for he looks to the ends of the earth and beheld everything under the heavens so as to sign a weight to the wind and determine the waters by measure. This is godly seeing, and this is wisdom. It's almost as if the creation is x-rayed through and measurable. And this is what humans do too. And this is what the writer calls wisdom. So the Lord's answer is answer to the hymn to wisdom, you see. When God then calls Job to this tour of creation, it's not a put-down, petulant. It's come with me and see into the deep structure of wisdom. Have you gazed on the fullest expanse of the underworld? Say if you know its extent. Then he starts talking about what you do with chaos wisely. Who cuts a channel for the torrent of rain, a path for the thunderbolt, to bring rain on the uninhabited land, making the thirsty ground sprout? It's not that you turn the chaos off. Yes, Job, I can present you with a completely ordered world if that's what you want. It'll be as ordered as a crystal, as still as a stone, and every bit as dead. But I can give you a living world if I take the chaotic stuff and, like I did at the beginning of creation, bound it and mark it, not suppress it, but channel it. It's a challenge, therefore, both to a simplistic idea that creation can be hunky-dory and the simplistic encoding of morality. So, the Lord's answer to Job is a real answer. It subverts this desire of Job that God controls things. It reconciles him by taking him out of the centre of his little world and showing him the glories of creation, far beyond his wildest imaginations. And it's not a put-down, it's participative, it's invitational. Come with me, stand up, says Yahweh. Gird up your legs, gird up your loins, and come with me and answer these questions. It affirms the fundamental biblical significance of physical nature. And I think it's also eschatological. It points to a point, moment in the future where some of these questions will be answered, if not just yet. So there's something else. Do you remember we were searching? Absolutely. We were searching for a new story, a new narrative, a positive, Judeo-Christian, biblical, transporting narrative for science, because the ones that were circulating at the moment were despairing and dark and pagan. I told you those despairing narratives have been going on for centuries. Let's look at the book of Job one more time and take the different perspectives of the relationship between human beings and creation that it proposes. Eliphaz proposes that nature enshrines retributive moral law. If you're a good boy or girl, nature will be good to you, and otherwise not. Elihu says, no, it's an eternal mystery. Zophar says, no, it's a book you should read. Job is insistent that it's uncontrolled chaos. Yahweh at one point accuses Job of perhaps worshipping nature rather than God, the creator. But finally the voice that emerges is that our relationship with nature is our way to godly wisdom in the image of God and in obedience to our creator. Now look, exploitation, alienation, sacred, the book of nature, uncontrolled chaos, evil, the object of worship, desire. I told you these narratives of despair have been circulating for centuries. I was wrong. They've been circulating for millennia. They're the same five that Job addresses and that subverts with the way to wisdom. The way to wisdom that reconciles us with nature. And of course, like all theology, we start with the Old Testament, but we take it through the lens of the new to see how it then refracts into our own day. And it's not so difficult to do, because once you're attuned to this relational participative way of wisdom that works with creation, you see that the New Testament authors write about this all the time. Paul, who we often think of as being more interested in the spiritual world than the sarke, the flesh, but when we misread that, as Tom Wright has told us helpfully that we do, is completely saturated by physicality. Here's the ministry of reconciliation. God was reconciling cosmos, is the Greek, the world to himself, not just souls and spirits, the world, the whole enchilada. But he also talks about it in his reconciliatory terms. I love this soundbite, don't you? Paul summarizes our mission as redeemed people. He calls it the ministry of reconciliation. If someone comes up to you in the street and says, tell me, Jemima, tell me, John, what is this Christianity thing all about? The Pauline soundbite would be, I'll tell you what it's about. It's all basically about mending broken relationships. That's our business. That's the way you start. And of course, it's a beautiful soundbite because everyone gets that. We all know what broken relationships are. And broken relationships start with ignorance, don't they? We don't really know each other. That's why we get it wrong. They move on to fear. We're frightened of each other because we can do each other harm. That's the third thing. Ignorance, fear, harm. And that's exactly how we start with nature. We're ignorant of it, so we fear it. And so it does us harm. As we've learned in our last century, we do nature harm too. Classic broken relationship. And the most humble of all the ministries of reconciliation is the ministry of reconciling that broken relationship with nature. In fact, is what God's gift of science is for. Jim Dunn, St. John's College Dublin, one of the today's greatest expositors on Romans, I'm proud to meet him from coffee from time to time, says this of Romans 8. All creation groaning in outer sortness, a disjointedness about the created order, which makes it a suitable habitation for man at odds with his creator. As I promised, that within the hour I would get to this place. And here we are, an hour after he finished. And so here's my soundbite. You can tweet this, actually. It's Twitterable, 130 characters. And it's experimental. You're here to critique it. But more importantly, you're here to help us work out in question time where we go with this. Science is the participative, come on, Joe, relational, mend it. Co-creative, see into nature as I do, work within the kingdom of God of healing the fallen relationship, the fallen relationship of humans with nature. And this would be you could replace words in this, it would be a theology of all sorts of things. Theology of medicine is the participial relation, co-creative work within the God of healing humans with their broken bodies. Yeah. It's not rocket science, this. Actually, some of it is. So there we are. There's all sorts of things it does. It has a long history. It's got a high human aptitude. It takes us to wisdom and knowledge. It tells us why engaging with nature is painful. It tells us about the balance of order and chaos. It tells us that questions are more important than answers and we need to live with them. And it tells us that science can be situated as the work of love. So I'm going to go back to that for question time, but I'm going to finish there and just conclude that science is therefore heart of and part of a Christian worldview of healing. That science and faith are not oppositional. Look, science is what you do when God says, come and heal the world. And this is a strong calling for us, to leadership and voice. So thank you for listening to all that. Take care.
We have about 15 minutes for Q&A. I will I'll find your questions and direct them.
Okay. I've also got some homework here, because here are some questions you need some material to think of questions. Here are just 8-7 ideas that I have, each a different color, of where this might go.
All right, so the easiest possible question is, please answer number 4. But anyway, your question there.
Thank you. I was just wondering, your tweetable theology of science, I was wondering if you could apply it to one of the hot topics, like maybe nanotechnologies, like you mentioned earlier. Like, how would you apply your theology to one of those hot topics?
Fabulous. So that's number 4. That's a new underlying narrative of the public debate in these hot topics. So I happen to have prepared a couple of possible ideas to help you with that answer. This is not planted, but I'm not really psychic either. I just thought this question might come up. So here's an interesting thing. So here's one thing. Here's people from Bruno Latour, fancy sociologist. I'll put his quotes up there. But so a couple of things. One is, I thought that when I started this project, I would end up as quite a conservative sort of place, small c conservative, not political, too, in that there would be some a priori no-go areas. So fracking, which was the one you mentioned?
Nanotechnology.
Okay, so nanotechnology. Okay, right. So nanotechnology, like, you know, like making new bits of ourselves, you know, bionic people and so forth by injecting things that pretend to be proteins and do things. So maybe there are sacred places we can't go. You could probably tell already the conclusion I came to. It's interesting, isn't it? When you do some Bible study and you come out having your prejudices refuted, and that you find your Bible study has told you something you didn't think to believe something different than you believed at first. And what it tells me is that God gives us immense aptitude and power to share in the history of the physical creation and ourselves. And that a priori, there are no no-go areas. But that surprises you. It surprised me. But that doesn't mean that anything goes either. Because when we go into nanotechnology or genetic medicine, we go into it not for profit, not for power, but with a bias to the poor, with healing, with all the biblical values of care for creation. And we do it with not behind closed doors and in darkness, but in public, and a debate in which the church can speak strongly. So here's something that's really happened. I've seen this happen. Much of these public debates, one of the reasons they go so sour is because they are characterized by two evils. One is they're characterized by a lack of truth, or even lies. What are the press saying? Have you even read this? You must have read this. They're talking about a post-truth politics now, aren't they? Have you read that? Post-truth politics. Brexit vote was post-truth. You know, we're in this dreadful, you know, well, you know, whatever you think about the decision, the process was just terrible. Now in the American presidential election, they're fact-checking, aren't they? Fact-checking is about lie-checking. Post-truth. And the other thing is fear. So much of it's think of Prince Charles. You know, grey goo. Think of the fracking and turn on the taps and flame comes out. There's misinformation and fear. Now, what's the most common commandment? Does anyone know what the most regularly repeated commandment in all scripture is?
Don't
be afraid. Yeah, it's not the adultery one. It's an important commandment, and it's not the most important one. It's not the most often repeated one, though. It's do not be afraid, do not fear. And it's end again and again. God hates fear. So we actually had a debate, St. John, we've got this project, it's also funded by Templeton World, just like this evening is, where we took a lot of Christian leaders, as bishops and other senior Christian leaders from Baptists and Methodists and Pentecostals and all sorts, and we talked about earth sciences and the applied trouble. It was not nanotechnology, it was fracking. And the reason it was so interesting was because one of the bishops is leading an anti-fracking campaign for his community, and another one is now ordained, but used to work as an earth scientist for the oil industry. And he's quite pro-fracking. So we had in the room all the ingredients for a bus stop. But we didn't have a bus stop. We had the... And so I brought in Professor Richard Davis, who is one of the UK's leading earth science and technologists, who understands the whole business about permeation and drilling and stability and diffusion. He understands the whole thing. And he's really good at explaining it. And we said, look, can we realize in a little day this vision of a community of humanities-trained senior church leaders who are open to going down, working hard at the technology and having a serious debate that moves us on, but framed by truth. So truth come in the door, fear, out you go. And I just saw a little glimmer of what might be true if the church really got going with this. So that's how I would start. Does that help point us in the right direction?
All right. Any other questions? We have about 10 or so minutes for more questions.
Yes, Ben. You mentioned N.T. Wright in passing, and it occurs to me that a lot of what you're saying is really like the undergirding.
Mentioned what in passing, sorry.
You mentioned N.T. Wright in passing.
Yeah.
And it occurs to me that a lot of what you're doing is sort of like the undergirding of his theology. And I'm just curious if the two of you are in dialogue.
The two of us are in monologue. I read everything he
does. I think you would add some
I do know Tom a bit, because when I was actually, it's been lovely, I wrote to him. I have read everything, just about. No, not everything. He writes far too. He writes books faster than I can read. It's not fair. Unbelievable. Awful man. No, he's lovely. Because he was Bishop of Durham when I was Vice President of Research at Durham University. So the university was his kind of research base. And so that was lovely. In fact, I've known him for a number of years, and he has a copy of the book. I did give a talk at St. Andrews, and I was desperately disappointed when he cried off at the last minute. I hasn't actually heard this. I really, really want to ask Tom what he thinks about this. But there we are. Well done, sir. You spotted. I've learned so much from particular, of course, what you learn when you read Tom Wright, he opened my eyes to the big narrative, to the overarching narrative. Yes, of course, it's important to read and study scripture under the microscope, but you've also got to throw the microscope away and see the big picture. Mm. And that's, I remember getting so excited about that when I first read his work on Luke.
Angelina's had a question.
Yeah. Thank you so much for opening the book of Job like this. I've never heard that. Mm. Are you in contact with Hugh Ross? He's written a book called Hidden Treasures in the Book of Job.
No, I don't know that one. Hugh
Ross.
Ross.
Yeah, he's a scientist down in L.A.
Yeah, Hugh Ross is from the institution called Reasons to Believe.
Oh, that one. I follow Twitter, follow their Twitter feed, yeah. Oh, no, thank you. I mean, I have to say, I'm embarrassed to have said no, but only partially because the literature on Job is simply vast, and not just theological. I mean, so when I said Susan Nyman proposes Job as the sort of foundation of all philosophy, she's got some evidence behind it. Basil the Great wrote about Job. The great church fathers wrote about Job. Robert Grosseteste wrote about Job. Kant wrote about Job. Carl Jung wrote about Job. And Karl Barth wrote about Carl Jung writing about Job. Useless of biblical studies. But I'm actually really, really excited because in church dogmatics, Barth has this well-known little small print epilogue at the end of his reconciliation version in Dogmatics 4.3.2, and it's impossible to get it on the internet, and I've wanted to get this and read it, and I have struck gold at Regent College Regent College Bookshop, because Bill's Regent College Bookshop is the best theology bookshop I've ever seen. So I went in and said, here's a test. If they claim this is such a good bookshop, okay, here's my test. I want to be able to go and pull off Barth's dogmatics on Job from the shelf and go home with it. I had a choice of two editions. So Bill gave you one. It's all there. So yes, Emmanuel Levinas is writing about Joseph.
Just one more question about another book. Slaying the Dragons by Alan Chapman.
I have heard of Slaying the Dragons by Alan Chapman, yes, but I haven't read it. Should I read it?
It's really interesting. He tackles a lot of what he considers to be the myths of the war between science and religion.
Oh, okay.
Tries to kind of explode the idea that it's always been Christians saying science is horrible.
I suspect I know what's in that book. There's another great book on that. If anyone come across Ron Numbers, Galileo Goes to Jail and 20 Other Myths in the History of Science and Religion. That's a great one. Galileo didn't go to jail, by the way. Just in case anyone thought it did. And it's well footnoted, it's lovely. Ron Numbers is an atheist, actually, but he's incensed at the misinformation around the history of science and religion, and you're absolutely right. By the conflict, actually, narrative was invented, and we know exactly when it was invented. It was invented in the late 19th century by a number of people. Two of the most prominent are Andrew Draper and Charles White. The Draper White thesis, one of them founded Cornell University, actually, and they wrote books, great polemics, with titles like The History of the Eternal Warfare Between Science and Religion. They're polemics, they're not history. So Peter Harrison is a great historian writing about this today, says, that this, no historian of science or any background flavor whatever takes any of this seriously at all, and yet it's still current in public mythology. So plenty of books like this. Thank you very much. If you could just, after I could just come and write those books down, I'd be very grateful. Any other questions, thoughts, ideas for the homework? Go back for No, you know all the answers now. Church inside. Oh, look at that. That's. Oh, no, I'm not going in the wrong direction, that's why. Okay, now you know the rest of the story.
So, any further questions for our speaker this evening?
Earlier, when you said, I recall quite many times in creation stories, I just I got sidetracked. Do you mean allegorical or literal? You say creation stories?
Well, stories about creation. They don't come with little
allegorical sense.
They don't come with flags that say I'm literal and I'm allegorical, because they just are there.
So
what you need to do in reading creation stories in scripture is to read all of them and ask yourselves, what is their reason? What are they there for? What is the message they have? They certainly, and of course...
Which ones are true, then?
Well, they're all true. They're okay. All true, aren't they? They're all true. Scripture is full of truth.
Okay, that's good.
Perhaps one more question?
I could ask one, if no one else.
Mark's got a question.
I was wondering, Tom, if you could give some examples of other technologies that have been feared but turned out to not be very, like you mentioned nanotechnology. Are there other others? Are there
yes.
good examples?
I think there's quite a recent example. I know a guy I've come to know quite well over recent years in the UK, Sir Robert Winston, who's a practicing Jew, actually. He's a very wise guy. So he pioneered in vitro fertilization in the 80s in the UK, and I think was one of the first, may even be the first in the world. But if you remember the debates of the late 70s and early 80s, the idea of arranging conception, in a lab or in a petri dish or whatever it is, and then replanting the egg, gave rise to visceral horror. Really, people were shocked, it seemed to touch all those narrative nerves all the sacred nature, you can't do that. Conception happens in the dark, hidden space. On that glass, you know, Pandora's box. If we do that, it lets out everything. And they all trailed out there. The Daily Mail trumpeted, you know, Franken babies. Oh, you can always spot the narrative of fear, because your red top press will attach the two syllables Franken in front of the thing they want to stigmatise. Franken foods, Franken jelly, Franken, you know, and it comes from Mary Shelley. Oh, by the way, which is a complete misuse of Mary Shelley's book, by the way. What is Mary Shelley's point in Frankenstein? Now, we might as well get this out for the sake of the students. What is Mary Shelley's point in Frankenstein? By the way, Frankenstein is the name of the professor, not the monster. That's the first thing we need to know, okay? It's Frankenstein's monster. We don't know the name of the monster. And that's the point, one of the points. Mary Shelley's accusation is not that Dr. Frankenstein did a wicked thing by making the monster. He made a wicked thing by making the monster and then not loving it, and then abandoning it to its fate. That's the critique. That's really worth remembering. But now, think of the couples, you know, the couples who would be childless and are now not, and the children and grown-ups and adults who would not now be alive, who are now alive, thanks to this wonderful, wonderful technology that we're able to do in sort of reconciling some of the brokenness of our current world and making it well. So I think that's a good example.
Yeah.
Not so far away. Many, many others, but that's one.
So it's actually 8:30. We'll end our conversation here. Tom, you have filled this day with riches and treasures for us to enjoy this evening and throughout this day, and we greatly appreciate that. Let's give Dr. McLeish another round.